author, CEO, and founder of TerraCycle and new company Loop. Please welcome Tom Szaki.
Hey, you guys. Thanks for having me here. It's really fun to be here with you today. And it's actually really cool that there's lots of familiar faces in the audience, a few partners of ours as well. So I want to take you on a little journey around how we look at waste and what type of innovations we're doing. Just for a bit of context, this is where we operate today. One of the reasons I put up this slide is that what you'll notice is almost every country where we run our services are developed regions. We actually, as a foundation now, opened up in India and Thailand, and we found that the way waste works in the world is completely different from a wealthy region like here in the United States or the UK or Australia, where really we're trying to move from disposal to recycling, maybe reuse, from emerging markets where everything is littered because of lack of infrastructure, and we're trying to really move to bring some of that infrastructure to bear. But I think before we go into, the solutions, I think it's really important to understand the genesis of the waste problem. And so if we take a journey on waste, I think the most obvious thing, we learn this in school, is that it's not natural. It's only a human idea. So if it's a human idea, then the question is, when did it appear? And I can actually pinpoint this for you. It's not even that long ago. In the 1950s, this started happening. This is an actual advertisement saying, why bother reusing when you can just throw it away? And I know, we look at it like one of those tobacco ads from the 50s, right, where your doctor recommends Camel cigarettes. The 50s were a weird time. But it's important to acknowledge the virtues, right, which is amazing convenience and affordability. And that's why disposability won. I mean, we're voting for it today. You had choices out there of getting a durable coffee cup and a disposable coffee cup. And some of us chose the other one. So what happens? 25% ends up in our ocean. We all know about this, but the big unwritten story here is that 95% sinks to the bottom. Only 5% floats like this and can be trapped in systems. 2% declining is what's recycled, and the balance we burn or bury, or if we want to use more fancy words, incineration or landfilling. So then the question becomes, okay, if this is the case, and we have a lot of what you would call linear products, whether it's a chip bag or a coffee capsule or whatever, that ends up in landfills or incinerations, how do we solve that? How do we get at least those things to start and getting, to be recycled? And in fact, you heard from some of the other speakers earlier today talking about how recycling is like a critical first step to take. Again, to do that, let's understand what makes something recyclable versus not recyclable. And the white elephant in the room is that everything in the world is technically recyclable today. So it's not an issue of, is there a mousetrap or a technology that can recycle something? It has everything to do with this simple equation, which is sort of the magic equation of recycling. What makes something recyclable is if a garbage company can make money at doing so. And what makes it not recyclable is if the cost to collect and process it would be more than the material recovered. Here's a simple example. In Europe, which has more advanced recycling than here, clear PET bottles, like a soda bottle, is recycled at a very high rate. The moment you add color to it, like green, and make it into a Mountain Dew or a Sprite bottle, that color adds enough contamination that it becomes not recyclable anymore. You still put it in your recycling, but it just gets thrown out at the other end. And it's that little change can tip this overall equation. So the first thing I want to show you is everything can go into a circular process. And everything you're going to see, while it may look like this is at a Sunday farmer's market, this is at Walmart, where 35 million plants were packaged in used margarine containers. So everything you're going to see here is at much bigger scale than it seems, whether it's a million soccer balls made from juice pouches for the World Cup, whether it's bags. So the first thing you saw was reuse, then upcycling. And upcycling is really valuable from a sizzle point of view, a way to get attention, whether it's dresses we made at museums, let's just say you're totally prepared to party with that dress. Whether it's, people, by the way, here is a good example of the use of upcycling. He's promoting two products, but you only really notice one. The other one's a little lost compared to the impact of the upcycled jacket. But the real volume solution is the science to the waste. For example, we today recycle cigarettes in 11 countries around the world, about to celebrate our billionth butt recycled. There we take them, shred them, separate the ash tobacco paper, compost it, and then take the filter, which is actually plastic. Most people think it's a cotton or something. It's actually a plastic that's made into that type of product. I know some of you folks here worked at Participant Media before. We had a TV show on their channel Pivot for 3 years, so I'll tell you a little clip from one of the episodes where we took a pretty unique waste stream.
It's already taken. Make another one.
Tonight.
I found another partner who's interested in recycling latex, and I got some samples of their product.
A new assignment.
You want to collect used condom.
I can tell you're really excited about it, Rick, so...
Thrilled.
Might be a bit of a stretch.
Condoms are not really something I use.
Even for these scientists.
You can use it as a helmet.
Human Resources, all new, tonight at 7:30. On Pivot.
Now, clearly that's a joke. It's, you know, it's a better episode about condoms than balloons or plastic gloves, but, you know, exact same thing. So you take it, you cryo-freeze them, which makes them brittle, because vulcanized rubber is very hard to melt. In fact, you can't melt it, hence the vulcanized nature. You cryo-freeze it, you stomp it with an industrial hammer, you get a powder, and that powder can then be made into the grit on plastic gloves, so you can hold an object. Everything can be recycled. Whether it's shipping trucks, these were for the Super Bowl, where 30% of the plastic was replaced with used post-consumer potato chip bags. Or whether it's gardens, this is in London, made from aerosol containers. Whether it's over 25 gardens in food deserts in the United States made from cosmetic waste. Or playgrounds made from flip-flops. What I'm trying to show you here is that it's not a technical issue whatsoever. It's entirely an economic issue, which gets to, well, then how do you fuel the collection? Today, there's a 250 million people around the world who collect in our various TerraCycle programs all sorts of waste streams. It could be ones that have been funded by brands. Here's an example with Walkers, which here you would know as Frito-Lay, where today 10,000 locations across the UK are collecting and recycling. They call it crisp bags or here chip bags. Everywhere you can be putting these types of systems in, and the way we try to do it, because it doesn't make economic sense to recycle a chip bag, is we try to find stakeholders. In this case, PepsiCo, it could be a retailer, who funds the economic difference, and that is the unlocking mechanism to make something recyclable. Here, for example, is how diapers are now actively being recycled with us in Amsterdam. So if you're in Holland and you have kids or you know, you're elderly, you can find one of these bins through an app, and it'll open it for you. You can put any brand of diaper into it. It'll incentivize you after you've deposited diapers with coupons to Pampers. That's what pays the bill. And then they're taken and recycled into all sorts of fun things, like a toothbrush. Actually, just kidding, a little bit. So anything can be, right? There's no limit, whether it's cosmetics all over the world. We're the largest cosmetic recycler, from boutiques like this in L'Occitane to large brands, all the way to aerosol containers in Germany. This is the number one, not just the number one driver of car seat sales, but this program at Target recycles 250 full trailer loads of car seats a month that come in. Once you start seeing them peeling back the surface, the level of these waste streams is absurd in its overall scale. You know, many times in industry, we focus on how do we make sure our factories don't produce any waste, but everything leaving the factory is by definition waste. So, you know, we have to look at both sides of this equation. Whether it's power brushes and toothbrushes in Korea, again, just to show you that there is, everything can go. Cigarettes today in 400 cities around the world, even Los Angeles, have these type of recycling bins. We even just launched that in Mexico for chewing gum. So everything can be recycled in the end, which is good. But then the question becomes, okay, how do we get the waste back into products? So every example I showed you so far, the waste is not going back into what it was made from. Chewing gum goes into bird feeders or shoes, but not back into chewing gum. So the next question is, how do you get the waste back into the products to begin with? Now, we do many different materials. It's not time to show you them all, but one of the most iconic materials that we talk about today is ocean plastic. You saw the picture before. We run today thousands of cleanups of directly from the ocean with fishing vessels, rivers, lakes, and then beach cleanups that look like this. This one's in Panama in the San Blas Islands, which is an Aboriginal community that doesn't have disposability except what washes up on their beaches every single day. And you clean it up, and the next day, it's the exact same situation. Now, you know, you all know about this issue. You know, we were given ocean plastic bracelets. I hope you're all sporting them. They're pretty awesome. You know, so we know about it. I want to sort of peel back the surface and show you how do you use economics to at least bring some level of solution. So this material is collected 30% from oceans, 20% from rivers, another 10% from lakes, and the balance washed up on beaches, taken to our local warehouses. We sort out some pretty nasty stuff, dead fish, you know, and other contaminants that may have been in these things. And then from there, we process it into a high-grade plastic, and that ends up, say, in this, which is the world's first shampoo bottle made 25% from ocean plastic. And that's lovely and cute and great. The key question here is, what's the business model? Because that's maybe what you can leverage, you know, whether you're a student, whether you're, you know, someone with a voice, whatever it may be, to get more organizations to do this. The big challenge in getting a company like Head & Shoulders, the number one shampoo in the world, to put recycled content into their bottle, it's all economics. They want to put it. They are good people who want to do that, but they'll also say, look, we need the performance to be the same as the virgin counterpart, the stuff made from oil, and we need it to be the same price. And I put this example up for you because here, not only is it's way more expensive to do this than normal plastic, not even comparable, we're talking a whole order of magnitude more, and it degrades the plastic and makes an iconic bottle that's usually white in color gray. First time they've ever changed their color, and it wasn't easy to accomplish that. So what made that happen, and why is this live in 25 countries now? The reason is because if you look at the system broader, Head & Shoulders has to spend a lot of money on advertising. By taking those advertising dollars and putting them against running the supply chain I showed you, you can move money over, and you don't have to advertise a product like this because it oozes purpose, people love it, people talk about it, and that chatter offsets the cost of marketing. And that ability allows for projects like this to be implemented, but also scale at a tremendous pace. In fact, it just launched here in the United States. This is at Target just a month ago with Herbal Essence and became a big success. And now it's going into many other retailers, more countries, and so on. Whether it's dish soap, here you'd know this as Dawn. In Europe, it's called Fairy, which is 100% recycled, 10% ocean plastic. Even luxury cosmetics like Ren with Unilever, where it's 20% ocean plastic. Now, I've showed you two pieces. How do we collect and recycle? And how do we integrate recycled materials? And it all boils down to economic business models, especially if you want to move today and you want to scale. But the problem is, this is not the solution whatsoever. We cannot recycle our way out of waste. In fact, the word recycling, if you looked up in a dictionary, would need the word waste beside it. Recycling is the best way to manage waste, but do we want to be managing it or do we want to be without it? And so this took us on a journey where we asked ourselves the question, how do we solve waste at the root cause? And the answer was, we have to redesign out of our current systems because disposable systems can only go so far. And this was launched actually at the World Economic Forum in Davos this January. And what I really like about this panel of, you know, is the CEO of Procter, CEO of Pepsi, but the most the person I was most excited from was Jennifer, who is the global head of Greenpeace. All on the same stage, ushering in this new platform, which you'd never expect happens. Usually Greenpeace is out there picketing the same companies they're here on stage with. And again, if you're going to innovate, you've got to take a step back. So if waste was invented in the 1950s, the very concept of it, what did it look like in 1930? And it looked like this guy. I mean, who here has cobbled their shoes? In the past year, I'll be generous. Raise your hand proudly if you've cobbled your shoes. If we were here in 1930, 100% of you would have put up your hand. 100%. Let me ask you a question. If you were a middle-income woman in Paris, I just happen to know the stat for France, in 1920, how many apparel items would have you bought per year? Anyone? Just yell out a number. Two. Two apparel items. How long would have they lasted in years? 20 years. Okay, let's go forward, you know, 100 years to, you know, today. What is, how many apparel items does a middle-income French girl buy every year? 65. Very close. And check this out. You can't do time anymore. How many uses before disposal? How many times are they used before throwing them out? Three. And America is worse, by the way. That was a generous example. We're a little worse than that. So what happened back here was, there's a really interesting, unintuitive thing. The person who owned the package or the product in the milkman model, whether it was motor oil, whether it was, you know, beverages, was the manufacturer. And because of that, the person making was financially, selfishly motivated to make it long-lasting and durable. Because the word sustainability didn't exist in this time. Then what happened? And by the way, this is an actual advertisement promoting disposability. This was someone paid to put this out. Now we have to honor what it's promoting, which is incredible convenience and affordability. And let's remember, we're an enlightened group sitting here, listening to, you know, cool people talk about this stuff, and we have multiple times today voted for disposability. Look at what's on the floor in front of you. Look at the coffee cups in the back. That's what you actively could have chosen to avoid. And then on top of that, there's all the stuff that we cannot choose to avoid. If you flew here, the meal that they give you on an airplane, whether you ask for it or not, is made for you and will be thrown out. All the food service prep, you know, that made the beautiful stuff, you know, here, came in packaging, came in bags, all this stuff. Whether you eat it or not, it can't be avoided. So there's the avoidable and unavoidable, and we're voting for it all day long, and our eyes are open. Imagine the people whose eyes are not open. So we have to honor what it's preaching, which is affordability and convenience is what people want today. And I agree with, you know, whether it's 5 years or 11 years left on a tipping point, if that's the case, we don't have chance for cultural change. Because cultural change requires decades. It requires school. It requires generations. We need to act now, and I think the way to do that is to play into, unfortunately, the selfish desires of us as consumers, which is we want cheap, affordable, and shiny new stuff. And let's accept that and play into it. Now, a really weird thing happened when this happened. The packaging of all these products became your property. So you took that bottle, right, the one down there, and you, I imagine, want the water, right, inside it. But you own the bottle. Are you going to cherish that bottle for many years to come? I mean, so it's your property. It was given to you. You know, or do we cherish the Starbucks cup, you know, once it's empty? Do we cherish the Mars wrapper once there's no chocolate in it? And yet we own it, so why should we? And then a really weird thing happens. When we own it, the packaging becomes a cost to the manufacturer. And the goal of manufacturers, because they want to democratize products and increase margin, is to decrease costs. So here's what happened, say, for Pepsi, who's one of our founding partners in this platform, from when they began reusable glass bottles to where they're trending now, which is multi-layered pouches like a juice pouch. The reusable glass bottle was reused at 95%. Aluminum cans today in the US are recycled at 60%. PET bottles at 25%. Cartons like the one we have here is at 11%. Pouches at 0%. They're all technically recyclable, but there's less value to, for waste management companies to get, so they are less motivated to go get it. But another weird thing happens. If you were to get any beverage you wanted magically appear in front of you, which of these pack forms would you prefer it in? Just, you can yell it out. Glass? Are we unanimous? And how about the least preferred? Okay, isn't that weird? There's a degradation of our delight. Actually, quality of stuff is decreasing, yet aren't we supposed to be advancing as a society? So the question became, how do we solve for the unintended consequences of disposability? I don't think they were intended at all. It's good people trying to do good things, which is the garbage crisis and also product getting less exciting, while maintaining the virtues, which is affordability and convenience, because if we're going to ask people to sacrifice, only 1 or 2% of people will do it. And the biggest unlocking principle in Loop was this. Sorry for it being sort of an economic slide, but if you buy a bottle of shampoo today, so you buy it in that, the entire price of that bottle is in the price of your shampoo. You're paying for the plastic bottle fully. It's yours. This is the new Pantene bottle in Loop, which is gorgeous, made of aluminum. I mean, it's unparalleled, but it's more expensive to make. But what goes into the price of your shampoo is just your use of it, which is the total cost over the number of uses plus the cost of cleaning. And that way, you can move to durable design without having to pay more. And durability, not just reuse, durability enables three things to occur. One is, yes, it becomes reusable, which is way better for the environment, about 75% better from a carbon point of view. But it also allows something I think many consumers care about who may not care about the environment, which is unparalleled design and features. And that, to us, is what we're trying to unlock here, is to think about how do we play into the people who don't quite care, who are not here today, who are the average person out there, and how do we change them without wanting to care? So here, for example, is some how your ice cream, as of 2 weeks, we launched this in Paris 2 weeks ago, in New York, northeast of the US last week. That's how your ice cream can now come if you're in that region. Double wall stainless steel. And not only is it reusable and beautiful, it keeps your ice cream frozen for longer. It melts in a perfect way, and so on. And whether it's Tropicana in reusable packaging or Quaker, whether it's smaller companies like Braum, whether it's mayonnaise in refillables, or your ranch dressing now in refillable containers. These are simple examples, but to me what was really exciting is when brands started really pushing the envelope and going into even more advanced examples. This is how olive oil now is shipping in France, which is maybe one of the most beautifully designed containers. Whether it's brands bringing back their original packaging or reinventing completely new packaging. This is Cascade, now in engineered plastic that can go around at least 100 times before it has to be recycled. Whether it's what your Tide now can look like, again, this is all live shipping as we speak, or something like seventh generation, if you want a different content, made in containers that you may actually want to keep out instead of hiding below your counter. Whether it's what wipes can look like with Clorox. So it's about trying to embed into every organization, not making an opinion on whether their product is good or bad, but having them move towards a reusable ecosystem. This is what luxury cosmetics now look like. This is what your new deodorant looks like. It's closer to an iPod design than it is, say, normal deodorant packaging in stainless steel, whether you like Axe or Dove or whatever flavor is interesting to you. What a lot of brands started thinking about, too, which was exciting to me, is not just focusing on reuse. Pantene this year, that's live today, compared to Pantene next year, which they just released, both reusable. But isn't that just another huge step in design? What also became interesting was now we have to not just think about making something once, but about it aging beautifully. The reason this Pantene bottle has two layers of metal is because the outside layer will attract scratches, the inside layer won't. So over time, as this goes to many, many, many different people from one bathroom to the other, the logo becomes, and the design becomes higher contrast. So it ages beautifully so that it can keep going around and around, whether it's what your mouthwash looks like. And this is actually an interesting example. I'm going to finish on this, which is that toothpaste, this is with Unilever, could not become in a tube because tubes wouldn't be durable. So they had to make it in a glass jar. But you can't put paste in a glass jar, so they also reformulated their toothpaste to be dehydrated single-dose tablets, so it's perfectly dosed, it's no water, and you can travel with it. And maybe one of the most exciting designs I saw was this one. So we, you know, had to think about, well, packaging, yes, we need to make it durable, a minimum of 10 uses, aspirationally to 100. But what about content? So we made the decision, if we can't recover the content from your detergent to your orange juice, we won't make any point of view. But if we can recover it, then we need to push that in the right direction. And so, for example, the top of this toothbrush is a recoverable object, but it, no matter how well I cleaned it, you wouldn't be comfortable reusing it. So when the toothbrush comes back, the top comes off, it goes to recycling, and the bottom, which you would be comfortable reusing, is cleaned and goes to the next person. And here is what your new manual toothbrush looks like.
Hey, now, I love it when it goes my way, my way. Hey, now, I love it when it goes my way, my way. Hey, now, I love it when it goes my way, my way.
So hopefully that gives you a little taste of what this is all about. It'll be coming here to California just early next year. So with that said, thank you.